The trade war escalating at a fevered pace this evening. President Trump just moments ago further raising tariffs on Chinese goods in rapid response to China's just this morning boosting their own tariffs on American goods. Steve Leisman is live at the Fed summit in Jackson Hole, Wyoming, with immediate reaction from one of the biggest central bankers in the world, Bank of England Governor Mark Carney. Steve, take it away.
Thanks very much, Melissa, here at Jackson Hole with Mark Carney, the governor of Bank of England. Mark, President Trump today escalated tariffs. China escalated tariffs. President Trump escalated. Talk about the global effects of this trade war between the U.S. and China.
Well, obviously can't comment on just today's effects, but if we take a step back, what's been happening is there's been the direct effects between the U.S. and the U.K., the U.S. and China of the actual tariffs, and you know they're starting to get up. Towards potentially over the course of a 2-3 year period, about 1 percentage point lower for U.S. GDP if they all remain in place. So there's the direct effects. But what's happening globally is a confidence effect on business confidence, not just in the U.S. and China, but all across those supply chains and then more broadly, because it's not, as you know, just a series of measures between those jurisdictions. We've had issues with USMCA, we have issues around auto, we have still have issues around steel, we have issues in terms of the technology complex, if I can put it that way. And those effects are at least as material as the direct trade effects, and those effects are impacting all of the economies around the world. Right. And that's what's starting to happen. And so now that's starting to play into the outlook for the global economy. And whether you're directly involved or not, it is impinging on the outlook. And for example, for the UK, it's starting to affect our own.
I want to get back to that. I think people need to understand, you were the Governor of Bank of Canada, before that Goldman Sachs, and played a critical role in the global central banking response to the crisis. So I'm teeing that background up for the next question, which is, are global central banks, do they have the tools to address the fallout from an extended trade war? And how well are they positioned right now to address overall global economic weakness?
Well, let me start with the second bit, yeah. Which is that we obviously have less policy room than we did in 2008. Or even than we did several years ago. Rates are very low. Certain countries are doing the quantitative easing. So there is less room. The central bank, the major central bank with the most room is the Fed because of the strength of the U.S. economy. So we have less room, but we do have room and we do have an ability to use that room. The judgment has to be is when do you deploy that firepower? And the question that's beginning to emerge because of the scale of the trade effects, is are a number of central banks going to ease policy for their own reasons, and then collectively will that provide an offset? Now, the one thing that won't happen is that changing the level of the bank rate in the UK, for example, doesn't change materially the cost of capital for a business in the UK, and certainly not a business in the US or elsewhere. 25 basis points doesn't make a difference there. What it can make a difference to, though, is demand in the UK and demand in other jurisdictions, and it's that effect which also provides some stimulus. So the direct effects, not just of the tariffs, but I really would emphasize the uncertainty that is being created by this the series of measures that are happening, and happening in a way that is somewhat unpredictable.
So we have our set of problems that you say we've shipped to you. You have your set of problems, which Fed Chairman Jerome Powell mentioned today,
yeah.
Brexit as being an issue for the United States. I want to ask you if you can be sure to keep your problems over there, but I don't think that's the right question. How much has it affected the UK? Is it substantially responsible for the negative second quarter outcome that you had in your growth numbers? And do you foresee that continuing?
Yeah, okay, well, there's two things. Yeah, the short answer to the question is yes. But let me break it into two parts, which is in the very short term, the first quarter was a little stronger than people would have expected. Second quarter is negative. Third quarter is going to be, we think, is going to be positive. But the underlying pace of growth is relatively weak. That up and down between those various quarters, those are companies building inventories in the first quarter because they thought there might be trade disruption, running them down in the second quarter, the auto plants doing the same thing, and then knock-on effects in the third quarter. It's noise, it's real activity, but it's noise in terms of the underlying pace of growth in the economy. Now let me step back to the second bit, which is how's the UK economy doing? Since the referendum, it's done pretty well. We've got unemployment at rates, you know, lowest in 45 years. Wages are growing just south of 4%. Inflation's basically at target. Business investment, and all of that has happened in a world where there's been a lot of uncertainty because of Brexit and what shape it's going to take. It's an analogy to the trade war. This gets to what we were talking about a moment ago in terms of, well, what can monetary policy do in those circumstances? Well, what we did in the UK was after the referendum, because we thought there'd be uncertainty. We brought him down. We did a variety of things, and that has supported other aspects of the economy. Now, well, business investment is actually running almost 25 percentage points below its previous trend. Businesses in the UK have quite reasonably said, wait a minute, I'm going to wait until, if they have any exposure to Europe, either upstream or downstream, they've decided to wait and see, well, what are the new rules of the game going to be? And see, that's part of what's happening worldwide, is people are saying, well, okay, well, I've got exposure to a Chinese supply chain or U.S. Let me see where this settles out, and that's why it's having a bigger effect.
I have to ask a direct question here. You only have 75 basis points of ammunition left in your primary tool, your interest rate. It looks like you've been stubbornly holding on to that. Is that ammunition you're holding on to in case there's a hard Brexit?
Well, no, two things. There's a couple of paths the UK economy can take. There's at least three. One is there's a deal. And some degree of that economic relationship, deep economic relationship, is retained. Now, in that world, we're starting from basically at full employment, inflation at target, businesses with a lot of firepower on their own balance sheets, good financial conditions, and we're likely to see some of the catch-up of that investment there and the economy pick up. That's a world, I know it doesn't fit with the theme of the day, where actually we probably would be raising interest rates at a limited, you know, limited pace, gradual extent, vice versa, but you get the point. Now, in a world where there's no deal and there's no transition, the other extreme, which is a possibility, not a given, but a possibility. Then in that world, we would expect that we're going to lose demand from Europe in the short term. There'll probably be an adjustment domestically as well, consumer spending, so demand goes down. We'll have to make a judgment in that world, because the supply capacity of the economy will also go down, because this is an economy that's very well integrated to Europe, and it's going to take a while. British businesses are very flexible, labor market's flexible, but you got to redeploy that. That takes some time, and so it's the balance of those two effects. On balance, I've said this before, my personal view is we probably would ease in that world, that scenario, but it's not a given, and it depends on how it shakes out.
So, changing gears, last issue, Governor Carney, I really appreciate your time and thoughts on this. You dropped a bombshell in the luncheon there. That's the way I was described. It's almost like a mic drop. You are exiting this job, like a mic drop. And you said we need to go to a global virtual currency. It's a 23-page speech. It's very heavy. Give us the thumbnail.
I want to know, did you just read the conclusion of the speech, Steve?
No, I read 14 pages, okay, and then good. I jumped okay, to the okay. conclusion.
So what's the point?
Give us the thumbnail. Why can't the dollar be the global currency?
Okay, the dollar is the global currency. We know that. The challenge is that the U.S. share of the global economy has been reducing. The dollar's share of payments, not just financial assets, but payments, a lot of payments between countries that have nothing to do with the U.S. are in dollars. And what happens in situations like we're in today, where the U.S. economy, to its credit, is relatively strong, is doing better, and the Fed has been doing the right thing, which is, they've adjusted policy, they tightened policy as it was strengthening. Now they're making, the Fed is doing the right thing, but they have adjusted and policy is relatively strong. That means rest of world policy is tighter than it needs to be. And that feeds back on the U.S. economy in a way that ultimately slows this economy. And it leads to a substandard outcome. And in a world where you only have limited policy space, it's a dangerous place to be. And it's so the trade issues we're talking about are reinforced by the structure of the monetary system. Now, I mean, you've asked a big question, so just give me a second. But now the issue is, you don't just jump to something new overnight. What we want in a multipolar world, I think we'd agree that we've got European engine, we've got the Chinese engine, we've got the U.S. engine of this economy, multipolar world, you need a multipolar currency. The question is, how do you get there? And I laid out some ideas of how you would get there.
And the bottom line, Governor, is that all of the pressure on the different in growth around the world would not fall on the dollar exchange rate.
Yeah.
It would be spread out if it was a global basket of currencies.
It would be spread out. It was a global basket of currencies. It's better for the system as a whole. It's better. It raises that equilibrium level of interest rates.
Right.
It gives central banks more policy, but it gives people who are watching greater returns on their savings.
Well, certainly worth thinking about. Governor Carney, thanks
for
joining us.
Thanks
and
for having
good
me.
Luck through the Brexit process, the trade wars, and the growth issues out there.
Thanks, Steve.
Thanks very much. Back to you guys. I guess you're in Englewood Cliffs right now.
We're at the NASDAQ. It's a long list of things.
NASDAQ.
Wish him well on. Steve, thank you. Steve Leisman with the Bank of England Governor Mark Carney. Mike Khouw, what do you make of this in the prism of the most recent ramp up in trade tensions with China?
Yeah, well, I think one of the things he just said, which I found it kind of interesting myself, is he was just talking about how central banks and maybe the Fed have less basically wiggle room or ability now than they had perhaps before the credit crisis. I'm not entirely sure that that's true. We have to first think about how much of an impact we think Fed can have and what are we actually talking about them trying to mitigate. Is it an issue of trying to support GDP in the United States? Are we trying to focus on employment? Are we trying to focus on inflation? Are we trying to focus on asset prices? I mean, that's what we're usually talking about on this show, right? I think it's kind of interesting because, of course, we've seen unconventional policy. And when you have unconventional policy like QE, then I'm not 100% sure that they don't have a lot of latitude. I'm not suggesting that. I'm not sure I want to see us go back to that. I certainly hope we don't need to. But I think that when we have unconventional policy that we can implement, there is a lot of room. There's almost unlimited room,
so I would basically suggest. Just thinking about the amount you can cut, that's deceptive because
entirely deceptive.
Tools.
That's right.
Right. We can reverse course on the balance sheet, I suppose,
exactly.
Right? That would be another tool. But remember, the magnitude of what we were facing in 08, maybe we had more tools, but the magnitude of the crisis was, this is nothing remotely close to that. But one thing that I thought was interesting that he said, just thinking about Brexit as sort of a, not that much of a microcosm, a smaller version mm-hmm. of our trade. You have a lot of uncertainty there, right? You have a date that might be certain, but you don't know how it's going to shake out.
Right.
And they are the fifth largest economy in the world. So that'll be interesting to see. The point that I thought was interesting, he talked about business investment being down 25%. We haven't seen that here, but that's where I'm afraid that uncertainty creates uncertainty. I'd much rather have a deal, even if it's not a great deal. I'd even rather have less back and forth, you know, just I guess it seems to me the actions haven't been so well thought out.
Right.
And that I wish that were not the case. I think the president does himself
thinking
a disservice,
things out,
particularly because he cares about the market.
One of the things that keeps, our economy strong, obviously, we have to focus on what's going on the business side, business investment and so on. And obviously, decision makers are going to want to have at least some clarity, some kind of a path ahead. And when you have absolutely no idea which direction you're going to lurch in next, that's actually what jeopardizes. It's not the magnitude of the tariffs necessarily that upsets me. It's what worries me is decision making that has much greater magnitude than the tariffs would.